Good morning and welcome to this online gathering of worship of Memorial Baptist Church. And we're so excited that you're joining with us, and we still wish we could be in person, but we're glad, we're so happy that you're joining with us as we worship our Lord and Savior together here on this Lord's Day. And we're just so blessed to be able to do that even in this little bit different format for now. We've gathered for no other purpose than to praise the Lord together, to worship Him through our song, through through the proclamation of His Word. And so we just want to go to the Lord and ask His blessing upon our time together this morning, that He would be glorified, that the name of Jesus would be magnified in all that takes place here in the next few moments. So would you pray with me as we begin our time of worship? Father in heaven, we rejoice in Christ today. We thank you that He is more than enough. He is all sufficient in our lives, worthy of worship, worthy of praise, worthy of our gathering, worthy of our lives. And Father, I pray that that would be apparent in our worship this morning. Father, we know that here in this strange format, there are opportunities for myriad distractions, many things to creep into our minds or to take our gaze away from Christ here this morning. But we pray that we would be focused on you, that our hearts would be pointed toward you, that we would hear from you in a powerful, powerful way in worship this morning. Lord, be glorified in this time we have together in worship. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope, no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in.
Thank you, my Lord.
Was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given away. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. With death was arrested.
Have made me new, now life begins. Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Yes, it did. For your grace, so
soul, there in the sweetest songs of men. same for the rich and poor.
Same for the saint and for the sinner. Enough for this whole wide world. Your great grace, oh, such grace.
Your grace washed over me. And for my brothers and sisters that are here with me, I know that your grace washed over them. It found us, Lord, and I praise you for that. I stand here with a humble heart, and we all know joy because of your grace, and I praise you for that. I love it, Lord. When death was arrested, that's when my life began. Oh, my new life in you. I praise you for that. Thank you for setting me apart, that I can be called a saint. It's very humbling. Thank you for that special privilege. You've given us each a special purpose as your children, as your saints. And I pray that as we serve you in this life, the time that you've given us here, that you would show us what that special purpose is for each one of us, that we could bring honor and glory to you. I thank you for my pastor. Thank you for your word that you've given him to share with us today. And I pray that you'll teach us today what it means to really be a saint and to be a servant. What a privilege it is. Forgive me for taking any of that for granted. Thank you for allowing us here to worship you. May you be honored and glorified in everything that we do. Amen.
I've got to tell you, it never gets old to sing of God's grace. Just singing there a few moments ago and reflecting on what that means in my life, I know full well that there is nothing worthy in me. There is nothing good. I'm a miserable failure apart from the grace of God. And I hope we see that grace come through powerfully in the reading and the proclamation of God's word to us this morning. And let's hope it becomes very apparent to us. I want to invite you to take your copy of God's word and open to the book of Philippians as we begin a journey through really my favorite epistle in the New Testament, and a powerful word from the Lord through the Apostle Paul to this church in Philippi. And so we'll be looking here in Philippians for several weeks to come. And I want to begin this morning by just looking at the first couple of verses and considering the greeting of the Apostle Paul to this church. And really, it's a greeting to an unlikely church, as I'm going to call it this morning. So I want to introduce this letter and take a look at some of the major players, not by name, just the groups, the saints, the servants, and most importantly, the Savior. We'll take a look at that. But I also want to pull in Acts chapter 16 just a little bit as we consider that great chapter of Scripture that tells us some important information about this church in Philippi as we introduce it. But first, I want to read the greeting here, just the first two verses in Philippians chapter 1 as we consider this text this morning. Beginning in verse 1, the Word of God says this: Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are at Philippi, with the overseers and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Will you pray with me? Father, this is your word to us this morning. And Father, it's just two verses, but there's such powerful truth in it. Such powerful application to our lives. And I pray this morning that you would speak through your Holy Spirit. That you would speak powerful grace, powerful truth into our lives as we learn what it means to be saints who are servants of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Father, bless our time in your word. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I imagine you will understand very quickly, very easily, what I'm about to explain to us. I think we've all had experiences in our lives where life didn't go quite the way we planned it to go. Now, sometimes those little interruptions in life, those unexpected turns, are really not a big deal. Sometimes we have an event planned and it gets canceled for some reason, and we might be bummed out for a moment, but it didn't really change life. It didn't really alter the course of our life in some dramatic way. If you get sent on a detour on your way home today, or as you're out on the highway, you might discover some great new experience, some great new shop or a restaurant, and who knows, but those aren't really big deals, those sort of unexpected turns, not too life-altering. But there are other times in our lives where things take a turn. Things change, life gets altered, and there's an unexpected turn that is what we might call a life-changing, life-altering turn. I'll give you an example. When some of my favorite missionaries, Adoniram and Ann Judson, when they sailed from Massachusetts on February 9th, 1812, they were Congregationalist missionaries headed to India to share the gospel with the people of India. Now, what it means that they're Congregationalist means that, well, they practice infant baptism. That's one of the significant differences. But so as they set out, that was who they were. That was their plan. That was their goal. But when they arrived in India on June 17th of that year, some things had changed. Some life-altering changes had taken place. They weren't Congregationalists anymore. They'd become Baptists by spending time searching God's Word on the many months of their boat ride to India, and they'd become convinced that baptism is for believers only. And so they became Baptists on the journey. Well, they also discovered, when they reached India, that the British were not too fond of having Americans in India, and so they couldn't stay. They had planned all of this time to share the gospel, to plant a church in India, and they had to leave India, and so they ended up in Burma. Their plans were changed. Their theology was changed. But the God they served did not change. God was glorified through this. Let me show you how God was glorified through this. When the Judsons arrived in Burma, there was nothing church-wise. There were no Christians among this people. But by the time of Adoniram Judson's death, he had seen 100 churches planted in Burma. He had seen over 8,000 Burmese people come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. In the year 2000, 150 years later, after Adoniram Judson, Burma has 3.5 million believers, and the third most Baptists of any country in the world. You see, that was a life-altering change, but look what God did through that. Sometimes God changes our plans, and He does it for His own purposes, for His own glory, and we may understand that, but then sometimes we don't. We don't know why He changes those plans. You see, He changed the Judson's path, and it led to the planting of an unlikely church in an unlikely place called Burma. Well, God did something similar many centuries before with the Apostle Paul, and He changed the Apostle Paul's path to plant an unlikely church in a place called Philippi. Now, I say it's an unlikely church because the Apostle Paul never intended to go to Philippi. As he's out on his second missionary journey, that wasn't his plan, that wasn't where he was going. Those weren't the people he had planned to go to. But Acts chapter 16 kind of lays this out for us. 10 years before he wrote this letter to the church at Philippi, Paul was in a place called Mysia. And he wanted to do some missionary work there in Mysia. But he says in Acts 16 that the Holy Spirit would not allow him to do ministry in Asia. So he came up with plan B. He had another plan. He was going to go northeast into Bithynia. And the text says the Spirit wouldn't allow him to go there either. And it's at this point when he experiences that vision at night, that Macedonian call, that vision of a man from Macedonia calling him to come over and help us, come over and preach the gospel here in Macedonia. And so Paul went west, and he went to Neapolis for a while, and then he went to Philippi, and he stayed some time in Philippi. It's an unlikely place because Philippi was a very pagan place. It was a colony of retired Roman soldiers. They were not Jews. They were not committed in any way to Judaism. They weren't committed to anything other than Rome. They were Roman soldiers. But Paul planted a church there, and 5 years later, he commends this church. He commends them as a joy-filled church and a generous giving church. They were supporting him. They were funding his missionary endeavors, even other places, after he left there. So let's take a deeper look at this church and a deeper look at this greeting to the church at Philippi. And again, I want to introduce those main players and help us understand them, and through that, understand who we are as the body of Christ as well. So we'll examine the servants, and then the saints, and then, of course, the Savior. So look with me first. This is a letter that is from the servants. From the servants. Verse 1, it's interesting. This is how Paul introduces himself and Timothy. He says, Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus. Now, I say it's interesting because that's not usually how Paul introduces his letters. He usually talks about himself being an apostle of Jesus Christ. And rightly so, in many places, he needed to establish that authority, to establish that he had been given this message from the Lord himself. And so he usually says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ. And as a matter of fact, the only other places in Scripture, in Romans and in Titus, where Paul introduces himself as a servant, he also adds that, oh, and an apostle. So this is the only place where he just says, servants of Christ Jesus. And I got to be honest, I don't know fully, I don't know exactly why he introduces himself this way as a servant here, but here's what I do know. There is no more exalted position among God's people than to be known as a servant of Christ. Sure, he's an apostle. Sure, he's a great missionary to the Gentiles, but most importantly, Paul was a servant of Jesus Christ. That's what he felt like he needed to communicate clearly to the church here. So what does it mean then to be a servant of Christ Jesus? Well, for one, it means this. It means servants are committed to the person of Jesus. They're committed to the person of Jesus. Now, understand this clearly. Paul is not a servant of the church at Philippi. He's not a servant of his circumstances that led him to end up in Philippi in the first place. Paul is only and always a servant of Christ Jesus. Now, that didn't always come easy. It wasn't always comfortable for him to be a servant of Christ Jesus. Sometimes it's easy for us to claim relationships to another person if we think it will benefit us in some way. If we think it will benefit us physically or benefit us with the comfort or with just whatever else we think that we might need. So, for example, when young people get into trouble, if necessary, they'll throw out the, well, don't you know who my parents are? Don't you know who my mom and dad are? You wouldn't be bothering me right now if you knew them, and you play that relationship card to get out of trouble. Other people, when they need to seem significant or feel like they are somebody, don't you know who I work for? Don't you know what my company is, who I associate with? As if to elevate themselves in some way. Listen, that's not what Paul is doing here. That's not the heart of the Apostle Paul. It's not what he's doing. He's associating himself with the one later on in chapter 2, we'll find out, made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant. He's associating himself with Jesus. And that's not always easy or comfortable. You don't become Jesus' servant for the comfort benefits. It's not why you do it. Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 10:22, you will be hated by all for my name's sake. If you want to associate with Jesus, understand you're going to be hated. There are going to be people who despise you because you claim the name of Jesus. He went on to say in John 15:20, Jesus did, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. This is what it means to associate yourself with Jesus, to claim to be a servant, to claim to be connected and associated with Jesus. You see, servants aren't committed to Jesus for all the good and comfortable things he can do for them, for the affluency he can bring into their lives. Servants are committed to Jesus because he's the greatest desire of their heart. Come what may, whatever the world will throw at them, whatever persecution comes, whatever hatred comes their way, they want Jesus, not because of what other people think, but because they can't conceive of a life that is not directed toward Jesus and that is not running full speed after Jesus. So these servants, they're committed to the person of Jesus. He is Lord. He is Savior. But they're also committed to the plans of Jesus. Servants are committed to the plans of Jesus. I noticed back in Acts chapter 16 that the Spirit of Jesus didn't allow Paul to go to Asia. He didn't allow him to do ministry there in Bithynia where he had planned to go, where he'd set up all of these plans and probably put a lot of time and effort into making these plans. And the Spirit said, no. Jesus said, you're not going there. You can't do it. I'm changing your plans. Well, when his plans were changed, Paul could have, I suppose, just have thrown up his hands and said, well, what's the point? What's the point? If life isn't going to work out the way I think it should, then I'm done. Then I'm just not. I'm just going to pout. We don't see this in the Apostle Paul. We don't see him throwing up his hands. We don't see him getting angry with Jesus saying, Lord, you ruined my plans. I had such great plans. He listened. He listened to how the Lord was leading him, and he concluded. I love the way the passage in Acts 16 concludes here with verse 10. It says that Paul finally concluded that God had called him to preach the gospel to the Macedonians. Why did all of his plans change? Because he concluded God had a glorious plan for him to take the gospel to the Macedonians. It wasn't what he originally thought. It wasn't what he originally hoped. But the plans got changed for the better. Hey, church, I wonder, how do you respond when your plans get changed? When life takes an unexpected turn, when you think you're headed one direction and Jesus closes that door very firmly, very clearly, and you get sent another direction, how do we respond when Jesus changes our plans? When a job doesn't work out and we think it's our dream job, we think it's the one that's really going to make us happy, it's going to really provide for our family, and it just doesn't work out. How do we respond when that loved one we've been praying for, and it looks like they're on the mend, and then they take a turn for the worse? How do we respond in those moments? When life isn't taking the path you thought it would, it isn't going the way you wanted it to, what about when you know God is asking you to do something difficult? It's going to cause you to change maybe even the very course of your life career-wise. How do we respond in those moments? Well, we know what servants do. We know what servants of Jesus do. They're committed to the plans of Jesus because they know the plans of Jesus are better than their plans. And they're committed to the person of Jesus because they know standing with Jesus is the most important thing in their life. Because they love Jesus most, not self. And so it may not be easy, but servants of Jesus are willing to follow Him even when their plans get changed. We see this in the example of Paul and Timothy. They're servants of Christ Jesus. They're committed to Jesus. They're committed to the plans of Jesus. In church, my prayer for us is that we would be so committed as well. Life won't go exactly the way we have it planned out. You just have to live a few years to figure that out. In my 40-plus years of life on this earth, I've seen life take some very unexpected turns. How do we respond when life takes those kind of turns? Do we see it as the Lord's still sovereign? The Lord is leading us in those moments. I pray that we do. This is a letter that is from the servants of Christ Jesus, Paul and Timothy. But it's also a letter that is written to the saints. It's written to the saints. I'll confess to you this morning, I don't fully understand how some people view this concept of being a saint. We know, especially like in the Roman Catholic Church, to be a saint, you have to have some kind of heroic virtue. Or you have to be a martyr for the faith. And you have to have at least one verified miracle to your credit. Or again, give your life as a martyr for the Lord. And then you have these venerated saints, now those who are declared to be saints, who are only a select few individuals amongst the whole group of believers out there. But that's not how Paul describes saints here in this passage. He says that the church is the saints. Listen, ordinary, transformed followers of Jesus. Saints. I'm so glad for the word ordinary, because that's me. And I suspect it's most of us. Ordinary, but transformed by the Holy Spirit, followers of Jesus. And so verse 1 says that this letter is to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are at Philippi. When Paul talks about the saints of Christ Jesus there in Philippi, he's talking about the entire church. Every one of them. Every one of them who are truly in Christ. So who are these saints at Philippi? Well, we don't get a list of them here in this greeting. But Acts 16 tells us they were a diverse group. A very diverse group. You have all sorts of people. First, you have a businesswoman. She goes by the name of Lydia in Scripture. So Lydia and her family become believers there in Philippi. And it talks about some other ladies who become believers as well. Maybe it's Euodia and Syntyche that we'll see later on in Philippians. But Lydia, originally from Thyatira, she comes to Philippi, and she's a businesswoman. She sells this expensive fabric, and she's wealthy enough to have this church meet in a large room in her home. So she's more of an upper-class lady here in the church. More of an upper-class lady. And she was new to following Christ. We have a businesswoman here, But on the opposite end of the spectrum, we have a slave girl. A slave girl who becomes a part of the church. We're told she has a spirit of divination. And she began to declare to the people who were listening all sorts of things about Paul there in Acts 16, verse 17. She confesses, "These men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation." Wouldn't it be incredible for somebody to just know that about you? Know that, hey, these are servants of the Lord. And they're here to proclaim the gospel, proclaim the way of salvation. But this girl was a spiritual mess. She was a poor girl. She was a demon-possessed girl before she encountered the apostles here. The power of the demonic, though, we see is no match for the power of Christ in her life. And when the gospel was proclaimed and the power of the Holy Spirit is unleashed in her life, the demon can't stay. Only grace can come in and fill her life with the Holy Spirit. And so we have a wealthy woman who's part of the church. And then you get this messed up, baggage-carrying slave girl who's part of the church. She's a saint. She's one of the saints. Well, there's another guy who's part of the church there. He's what we might call a government man. This is the Philippian jailer and his family. When Paul and Silas were imprisoned in Philippi, if you remember the story, there was an earthquake at the time, and it shook the bars of the prison loose, and so it seems like everybody's about to escape, and the jailer knows his life is forfeit at that point, and so he's about to take his own life. And Paul calls out to him and says, "Don't do that. We're all here." Well, that jailer knows there's something different about these guys. There's something different about the God they've been singing about, the God they've been worshiping, and he wants to know, how can I be saved? You have this jailer, this Roman official, middle-class working man, initially cares nothing about Christianity, cares nothing about the gospel of Jesus Christ, and then grace comes into his life and changes his life, and he becomes part of the church in Philippi. But then we're also told there are the brothers there in Philippi. Acts 16:40 mentions this group, doesn't tell us who they are. Maybe it's Epaphroditus that we'll see in chapter 2, but they're engaged with the gospel by Paul. He engages in remembering them there in Acts 16. And so you have this interesting mix, an interesting group of people there in the church at Philippi. And so we have the initial church there in that city. And as I said a moment ago, it's a diverse church, as it should be. There are men there. There are women there. There are wealthy people there. There are poor people there. There are those with all different sorts of experiences, all different backgrounds there in this church. Why? Because that's the community. That's the community that the church is a part of. You see, churches should be as diverse as their community. We should never have or desire to have merely senior adults on one hand in our church, or only young families on the other hand in our church. We should never cater toward the wealthy or only cater toward the poor in our community. The church should reflect the community. It should include everybody. You see, the church isn't for only those who grew up in church. It's for those with baggage. Those with spiritual baggage, like the slave girl we talked about a moment ago. Those who had incredible journeys of coming to Christ. The church is for them as well. The church isn't just for the well-dressed. For those with money to put on their best suits to come to worship. It's also for those who come as they are. It's also for those who just want to give their best to Jesus in worship, and that's all they have to give. It's for all people. The church isn't just for one ethnic group. The church ought to reflect the community in which it exists. The church is for all people. Now, it's important. If everyone in the church looks like you or looks like me, I think we're doing church wrong. I think we've got it a little bit messed up. We're doing church wrong. The beauty of the gospel is that we're united in something greater than socioeconomic status. We're united in something greater than ethnicity. We're united in the person and the work of Jesus Christ. The gospel is what brings together people who have absolutely nothing in common and wouldn't ordinarily associate with one another but for Jesus and what he has done in our lives. This is what the church represents. This is how the church is different, powerfully, distinctly different than any other group that exists out there in the world. We're saints. We're saints who are united in Christ. Nothing special in us, only what we know to be true about Christ and what he has done in our lives. So this is a letter. A letter that is written from some faithful servants. That is written to a very diverse group of saints there in Philippi. Very diverse group. But it's written for a purpose. It's regarding the Savior. Notice with me, thirdly, the Savior here. Now, I think on the one hand, we kind of expect that. When you read a New Testament letter, you expect this is going to be about Jesus in some way. This is going to be about the Savior because, you know, I mean, isn't all of the Bible really ultimately regarding the Savior? I mean, think about it for a moment. It would be like asking what that book in the glove compartment in your car is about. Well, we could begin talking about different parts of it. We could talk about the part that references the tires. Or the part that explains in detail the electronic systems of your car. But the bottom line is, the only reason that those tires or that electronic system has any relevance at all to the conversation is because it's ultimately about your car. That's the unifying theme. This letter to the Philippian church, and really all of Scripture, is ultimately about our Savior. It's ultimately about Jesus. And the parts that don't seem to be about the Savior, that don't seem to have anything to do with Jesus, they're pointing us to Jesus. They're setting us up for our need for Jesus. They're ultimately pointing us to the Savior. So here in the greeting of Philippians, Paul mentions his Lord. He mentions Christ Jesus three different times in two verses. So here are three reasons for his emphasis on the Savior, that he mentions him three times in two quick verses here in the introduction. Three reasons for the emphasis on a Savior. The first reason is this: we're servants because our Savior is our master. Because our Savior is master. Paul said at his conversion, that was one of the things that Jesus made very clear to him. Paul was to be a servant of the Master. And what he told to him, as Paul much later recounts this conversion experience and this first encounter with Jesus in Acts 26:16, he tells us what Jesus said to him. He said, Jesus said, "Rise and stand upon your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to appoint you as a servant and witness to the things in which you have seen me, and to those in which I will appear to you." Church, I want to be clear this morning. Just like Paul, if you and I are in Christ, we're to be servants of Jesus Christ. It's not optional. It's not only for super Christians, for those who really want to go to the next level in their spirituality, who want to be thought of as church leaders or really spiritual individuals. Being a servant of Jesus Christ is the call on every one of our lives. It's what Jesus modeled for us. He modeled that kind of servanthood for us. And in John 13:16, he said, "A servant is not greater than his master." He's our master, and he modeled for us the way of servanthood. And so Paul, he served the local church because he was ultimately a servant of the Savior of that church. And that has to be our heart as well. Christian, our service to the church sends a powerful message. It sends a powerful message that proclaims loudly, "I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. However He's calling me, whatever He's leading me to do, and let's be clear, He's calling you to something. He has gifted you to do something in the church. So we have the privilege, we have the great opportunity of being servants of this church, of Memorial Baptist Church, ultimately because we're servants of the one who is the Lord of this church, the one who is master of this church. We're servants because our Savior is master. The second reason for the emphasis here is this: we're saints because of our Savior's sacrifice. We're saints because of our Savior's sacrifice. Now, what does it mean? We didn't really talk about this earlier. What does it mean to say that we're saints? Because sometimes we can get the wrong idea and people think, oh, well, they must believe they're perfect. Saints are not perfect. Saints are not miracle workers. Saints have a miracle worked in them through the gospel of Jesus Christ as it transforms one who is dead in their sins and trespasses to one who is now alive in Christ. So what it means to be a saint is to be holy or to be set apart for God. If you're a follower of Jesus, you're a saint today. You've been set apart. You've been set apart for various things, for worship. You've been set apart in your holiness. You've been set apart to serve Him. It's descriptive of every person who's truly saved and in Christ. So being a saint, listen, it's not about what we do. Being a saint is about what Christ has done. He set us apart as the redeemed. It's what Christ has done. Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus in Ephesians 5:2, and he tells us Christ loved us and gave Himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. This is what makes us saints, that Christ loved us and He gave Himself for us. Do you believe that? Are you trusting in that alone today? Not in what you've done, not in what you and I can do. Church, let's strive to live what we truly are. Strive to live as set apart saints of Christ Jesus. Then we'll have every reason to emphasize, every reason to glory in this third emphasis. The third emphasis here of why we have this emphasis on the Savior is we have grace and peace because our Savior reigns. We have grace and peace because our Savior reigns. Paul's greeting to the Philippian church, it ends this way. If you look back in the text, verse 2 says this: grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Very simple. Very simple. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. This is Paul's desire for the church. This is his desire for this body of believers, this community of faith there in Philippi. How do we get that grace? How do we experience such peace? If I were, or if you were to receive an email today that told you that, or from Amazon, that told you that the UPS man was going to bring you a package tomorrow, you're going to have to assume a couple of things going forward from here. You're going to have to assume that there is a living, breathing man out there who goes by the name of UPS man, who is actually going to be coming to your house tomorrow. You have to believe he's there. You have to believe he exists. And you also have to assume that this UPS man actually has something to give you. Actually has a package with your name on it. And listen, we have no trouble assuming that. When I see that come into my email feed, I know there'll be a package delivered tomorrow. I assume all those things are true. And so listen, verse 2 speaks of Jesus in a kind of a similar way here. We understand similar truths. Verse 2 assumes that the Lord Jesus is living and breathing. He is active. He is reigning. Paul doesn't need to convince us. He just says, grace and peace to you. And by the way, that comes through the Lord Jesus Christ. He's there, living, breathing. He's Lord. He's reigning. He's Lord of this church. He's Lord of our hearts. He's no dead Savior, but a reigning Lord. And then he also suggests that this reigning Savior, he wants the saints to have grace and peace. This isn't something you have to go search for. Grace and peace are not something you have to beg the Lord for, plead with Him for. He wants to give it to you. He wants you to have them. And I know some Christians, and listen, to be real honest, sometimes even in my own life, I live as if grace is impossible and peace is nowhere to be found. And that just leads to anxious lives. That just leads to lives of where we're focusing on our circumstances and all of the things around us rather than on the one who is Lord of our circumstances. Sometimes we live that way. But here's the secret. It's an open secret. But here's the secret to having grace and peace in your life. First of all, know they're a gift from God. Understand that grace and peace are gifts from God. James 4:6 says that God gives more grace to help us overcome our sin. He willingly does that. God doesn't play hard to get. He willingly gives grace. John 14:27, Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you." He's not going to take it with Him back to heaven. He wants to leave it with us. He wants us to know that we can have peace. The world can be in chaos, can be falling apart around us, but Jesus reigns. And He says, "I leave you peace. You can live in this peace." So know they're gifts from God, grace and peace. But second, pray. Ask God for them. Ask God for them. Over in Philippians chapter 4, we'll get to it one of these days, we're told to pray, and then the peace of God will guard your hearts and minds. In other words, if we'll just ask, if we'll humble ourselves to go before the Lord and ask for it, the peace of God will guard our hearts and minds. He wants us to have peace. And then thirdly, I would say this, delight yourself in Christ more than anything else. Delight yourself in Him. Rejoice in His grace. Rejoice in the peace that He gives us more than anything else in life, because true grace and peace can only be found in Jesus Christ alone. There are no substitutes. There are no substitutes. Church, Paul's greeting to the Philippian church is very simple. It's not complex. We don't have to jump too deep into the text to really understand what he's saying. It's very simple. But it's meant to be simple. But don't mistake the simplicity and think it doesn't have profound truth for our lives. Profound truth for each one of us who are in Christ. And so I hope we see better this morning how to be servants of Jesus Christ. How to live out our lives faithful as servants of Jesus Christ. And how to live set apart, holy lives as saints in Christ Jesus. You don't need a miracle to your credit. You just need a Savior. You just need Jesus. We can be servants. We can live as set-apart saints, all because our Savior gives us more grace. He gives us the grace to do it. And so if maybe you happen to be listening to this message today and you don't get this grace thing and you've yet to trust Jesus for salvation, I want you to know this morning that Jesus wants to give you grace as well. He wants to give you grace as well. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 said, It is by grace that we're saved, and that grace is a gift from God. It's a gift He readily, willingly gives. I hope you'll trust Him today for it. I hope you'll trust in our glorious Savior. Know that He is good. He is worthy of giving your life to serving Him faithfully. He is worthy of having your life set apart for His glory and for His purposes, because He will give something you can't get anywhere else in this world. He will give grace in abundance, and He will give you peace to rest in each day. I hope you know that here this morning. Would you pray with me? Father, we've sung about Your grace. We have prayed for Your grace. We have considered Your grace here in this passage of Scripture this morning. And yet, we've barely scratched the surface of what your grace does in our lives and how it affects us, not just for the moment of our justification before you, but the way your grace powerfully works in each one of our hearts each day to help us run hard after Jesus, to help us serve faithfully as servants of Christ Jesus, to live lives that are set apart, that are not conforming any longer to this world, that are declaring in a very bold and public way that old life is gone. It's only the new life that remains, the life that we have in Christ. And Father, I pray this morning that if there's one out there who has yet to surrender their life to Jesus Christ, Father, would this be the day that your Holy Spirit would do that great miracle of transformation in their life? That you would regenerate them, that you would give them spiritual life so that they can see and understand and believe the gospel message of a Savior who died in our place so that we can be reconciled with you. Father, we thank you for the abundance of your grace. We thank you for the opportunity to worship you. Father, we thank you that you're good to us beyond anything we deserve. And we give you all the praise, all the glory for it here today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Servants of God, your master proclaim and publish abroad his wonderful name. The name of victorious, of Jesus extol. His kingdom is glorious and rules
for joining us today. God is moving in mighty ways through the message. What a great, great message to be shared, and it's for all of us to take charge of that in our lives. And a couple of announcements as we wrap up our service today is this. Treat to remember, on Thursday nights at 7:30, our youth are meeting via Zoom. Be watching for email and text links to be a part of that. This is for the youth to get together and fellowship and just be together, so make sure you be a part of that. If you're not getting those links, please contact the office or Nathan as soon as possible so you can be a part of that and your youth do not miss out. Also want to encourage you to sign up, or not sign up, but be a part of our daily readings. Right now, Monday through Friday, We're doing daily readings on the website. They'll be put out through our church, our website, nbcnewhaven.com. We're reading through the book of Acts. And just jump on there. They'll be posted every day at 5 a.m. in the morning, so you can get up early and read those and comment and let us know what you're thinking and be a part of that. It's a great time of just sharing and digging in the Word of God together. One other thing also, don't forget to join in the encouraging notes on our sidewalks and our driveways. There are people who come up here all the time from the community, and this is a great opportunity for us as a church family to be encouraging them and sharing the gospel through verses and encouraging notes to those who are walking around. So just come up and be a part of it. We have lots of chalk left, and every time it rains, we get a fresh start. So we've had to start over a couple times, but it's great because we can put new messages on there and new ways to share hope and love to this community and show them what it means to be the church, show what it means to be saints of God. And one final thing is also, don't forget to be consistent with your gifts and offerings. Like I said, right now, our offerings are taking care of the main ministries we have that are ongoing, the main missionaries we still have that we're supporting. And also, it's preparing us for whenever this whole pandemic ceases and filters out, that'll give us ways to be able to serve the community. And we're planting seeds now for those ministries of the future. So make sure you're being faithful with that and continue to keep giving. We're so thankful to have such a blessed church that is doing that right now, but we got to keep that going. All right, we're going to go ahead and end in prayer, and I want to invite you back tonight or Sunday night at 6 o'clock for another wonderful message. Let's pray. Father God, we just thank you. We thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing and through our church family, even though we're meeting in spirit, Lord God, through this internet and through the digital age. Lord, we pray that you continue to move through our hearts and souls. And Lord God, that we just thank you for this time of revealing us as saints, that you're working through us, Lord, and that you're doing mighty things through those who have surrendered their life to you, Lord God. If there are anyone listening to this prayer, listening to this message today that has not given their life to you, Lord God, we ask you to prick their heart and show them how they can be saved by your grace and your love, Lord God. Let that message reverberate through their lives, Lord, and chase them down, Lord. And as we head out, Lord, we pray that you move each one of us to share your grace with those around us and share what our place is, Lord. And we ask you just to guide us as we head out to do your work and do your love, Lord. We ask this all in your holy and precious name, and amen. Thank you for joining us.